Welcome to worship this morning, and if you're visiting with us, I'm glad that you're here. A welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us online. I've seen you popping in. We have several more than usual, so I'm grateful that you're here. If you have any joys or concerns to share, please put those in the comments, and I will be sure to bring them up during our prayer time. If you're in the sanctuary, there are pew pads. I would encourage you at some point to fill those out, pass them along. There might be somebody sitting in a different spot today. It's not because we want to know who's here, but people down the pew might want to know what your name is, especially if you didn't put your name tag on. There's my other plug. So I also hear my phone talking. No, we just have to turn it down. There's like 25 steps to go, and I missed one of them. So we also are anxiously awaiting our MCCI report, but you're going to have to wait a little bit into the worship service, so hang on. We'll get there. The announcements are on the back of your bulletin. I just want to call your attention to the school supply drive that's underway. And also, finally, we have another Hmong egg roll sale. So I know this church is always very supportive of that and pretty excited, and Cheryl is right there. She raises her hand, and if you don't get a hold of her, you can go ahead and contact the office. We'll get your order in. All right, let's begin worship this morning in song. And as we enter in, please stand if you are able and let us sing together number 140, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. We are called to worship. People of God, Let us gather to worship and praise God's name.
I give thanks to you, O God, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever.
For great is your steadfast love for me.
You have delivered my soul from the depths.
God says, know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. Please join me in the unison prayer.
Sower of the field, continue to be gracious with us, that we may ripen into the children
of God's realm and live with you forever, shining like your sun in God's heavenly home. Harvesting, God, as we listen to your word by your Holy Spirit,
Amen. You may be seated. Today's scripture lesson, the translation actually comes from the Common English Bible. It's Matthew 13, verses 31 to 33, and then skips to 44 through 52. Personally, I've noticed that when Jesus repeats something more than twice, you should probably be paying attention. He told another parable to them. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and planted in his field. It's the smallest of all seeds, but when it's grown, it is the largest of all vegetable plants. It becomes a tree so that the birds in the sky come and nest in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast, which a woman took and hid in a bushel of wheat flour until the yeast had worked its way through all the dough. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that someone hid in a field, which someone else found and covered up. Full of joy, the finder sold everything and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. When he found one very precious pearl, he went and sold all that he owned and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that people threw into the lake and gathered all kinds of fish. When it was full, they pulled it to the shore where they sat down and put the good fish together in containers, but the bad fish they threw away. That's the way it will be at the end of the present age. The angels will go out and separate the evil people from the righteous people, and will throw the evil ones into a burning furnace. People there will be weeping and grinding their teeth. Have you understood all these things? Jesus asked. They said to him, yes. Then he said to them, therefore, every legal expert who has been trained as a disciple for the kingdom of heaven is like the head of a household who brings old and new things out of their treasure chest.
Thank you. Thank you, Emily and Linda.
So I know that you're anxiously awaiting what Reverend Scott has to tell us, but you're going to have to wait. That's coming. First, we need to talk a little bit about Scripture. And if you were at our Thursday night worship, the reading is the same. And my plan was to sit down and write a whole new sermon for today, but that didn't happen. But I don't think you can talk about the kingdom of heaven too much. I did do some refreshing. The most important point after I read through my sermon and after I kept reading through the scripture is this. The kingdom of heaven is not so much a spiritual reality beyond this world as a spiritual reality breaking into this world. For Jesus, as for other spiritual teachers, the boundary line between earth and heaven is thin. In the gospel, Jesus even begins his preaching in Matthew 3 and his ministry by proclaiming the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And his mission was always to simply wake people up and make them aware of this new reality and the nearness of God in daily life. And that's exactly what we've been praying for in our breakthrough prayer, asking God to break through into our world, and then we discern where God is at work and what God is doing and what we need to do to join that work, to show people here in Hartford what the kingdom of heaven looks like. And we can learn a little bit more about it from the many parables that Jesus tells us in Matthew 13. First, there's that mustard seed. That little tiny bit of faith is all it takes, right? Now, I thought about this, and we've seen this theme played over and over again, even in movies. Just a little bit of faith and hope is all it takes. And one that came to mind as I sat down to do this was Little Giants. Who remembers that one? It was a comedy in the early 90s when Pee Wee Football, and my boys were, you know, about that age, so that was a popular movie in our house. Pee Wee Football was first becoming a really big deal. And let me say that there are other movies like this. You see this theme played out over and over again, like Facing the Giants and Underdogs, but Little Giants was the one I remembered the most about. There's a lot that goes on in this movie, but basically it's two Pee Wee football coaches who are rivals in the same town, and they each want the star player that just moved in to be on their team. There's deception. And one of the coaches even has a daughter that plays on the Pee Wee football team, and that causes a big issue. But a couple of things stood out to me as I thought about this movie. One is the coach is down on his luck, and he feels like there is no hope. And just when he runs out of all faith in everything, hope shows up. I think in the movie, it's something like this bus pulls up with these NFL players on it. I can't remember who was on it, but I know John Madden was one of them. They come in to inspire the team. They come in to teach them and coach them. And then on game day, the underdog team is down. And at halftime, the coach goes in and he gives them an inspiring speech and asks them to each remember a time when they had a unique accomplishment. And then, of course, lots of things happen during the game. That's the whole last part of the movie. But each of the players on the Giants team helps them score a touchdown. And in doing that, they have to overcome some of their own personal demons, like fear and family issues and a lack of confidence to help the team win. And it all started with just this little bit of hope and a whole lot of persistence. And I thought about that in comparison to the mustard seed and the mustard bushes that the farmer planted on purpose, and how that shows us the persistence of the kingdom of heaven. Once it takes root, you can't get rid of it. And I thought about this too the other day when I walked out of our condo. We have these three bushes in front of our condo. And when we first moved in the first summer, right next to the middle bush was this milkweed that grew up. Now, I left it because, first of all, in a condo, we don't do the landscaping. Someone else does. And I was kind of testing them to see if they'd mess with it. And I also kind of liked it because I love milkweeds. They're butterflies like them and other insects, so I wanted to let it grow. The first 2 years, they left it alone. This year, every time they come, guess what? They cut it. But guess what happens? Every time, it grows back. And it just reminds me every time I see it, I smile and I thank God that God is persistent and doesn't give up even when we want to. The next parable in the reading that we heard from Mary Beth is that Jesus compares the kingdom of heaven to yeast. And anyone who has baked bread knows what yeast can do. Just a little bit goes a long way. But in this parable, the woman put a little bit of yeast in 3 measures of flour, which is an equivalent of 50 pounds of flour. That's a lot of bread. And when she was done, we get this amazing loaf of fresh baked bread. You know, when you pull it out of the oven and the crust is hard and you break it open, and is anybody else's mouth watering right now? Mine is. It smells so good. It's a little bit of heaven, isn't it? But it teaches us that the influence of heaven is slowly growing in our world, just like the yeast in a loaf of bread expands. And it starts with just this tiny, insignificant pinch of leaven, and look at the result. In just such a way, the inbreaking reality of the kingdom of heaven has the power to transform the world. Then we hear about a treasure buried in a field. This farmer's plowing a field he doesn't own. He finds a treasure, and he is so amazed. He goes out and he scrapes everything he has. He probably goes and asks his family, his friends, help me buy this field because I want this treasure. The kingdom of heaven, Jesus is saying, is already present in our world. Maybe it's hiding in plain sight, but in such a way that not everyone can see it. But if we just glimpse it, and we glimpse its presence, we only have to reach out and claim it for our own. The last parable that we heard about was about fishing. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. And when it was full, they drew it ashore, they sat down, and they sorted it. Here too, the gifts of God, the signs of the inbreaking kingdom of heaven, are present among us already in great abundance. And anyone who's ever taken a fishing pole and gone out fishing knows that you cast this line into the water over and over again, and you hope that you will catch a fish. And in Jesus' parable, it's a net rather than a line, and it comes back bulging with fish. In fishing, every cast is an act of faith. The vast majority of casts yield no results, but it only takes one to make the day worthwhile. And then Jesus surprises us. He changes the whole explanation of this parable because we're looking at it like we're the fishers, right? No, we're not. In this parable, we are the fish. The keepers have to be separated from those that have to be thrown back. We pray in the Lord's Prayer about thy kingdom come, but we also pray the next line, thy will be done, divine judgment. So what is the kingdom of heaven like? Well, a mustard seed, leaven in a batch of dough, a treasure hidden in plain sight in a field, a net bulging with fish. The kingdom of heaven is not so much a spiritual reality beyond this world as it is a spiritual reality breaking into this world. The kingdom of heaven is both a mystery, because we have no idea what eternal life will look like, but we do know from these glimpses what the kingdom could be, and it's our job to live into it. May it be so. Amen. All right, we've come to the time. I need some ushers to come forward, or greeters, or anyone who can help. We need to pass these out. Everyone gets a copy. Thank you.
Test. Okay, when you receive your copy, please just leave it up. Don't open it up and start reading it yet. I will walk it through with you. And we just want to make sure everyone gets a copy of that. Does everyone have a copy? Make sure you get a copy. Linda, do you have a copy? Perfect. By the way, Emily and Linda, beautiful music. Thank you. Thank you so much. Cheryl, thank you for your words. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Scott Carlson. And on the one hand, you know, I'm director of congregational development, and so for the Wisconsin Annual Conference. So yeah, that means that I represent the annual conference. And but I want to tell you a little bit about me before I tell you about what I do. I was called to be a follower of Jesus when I was in elementary school. And I have committed my life to being a follower of Jesus. And somewhere along the way, I grew up in a church that frankly was not very kind to its pastors. And it was a church that that while I love dearly and I love the people there dearly, that they showed me how to love Jesus. But it's a church that often mixed up what was important. They focused on what they felt most comfortable with, much more so than how do we go where Jesus is calling us to go. And when I became a pastor, when I came into ministry, all I really wanted to do is help the churches that I was serving refocus on Jesus and reach out to the community and share that love of God with Jesus. And for 30 years, I served United Methodist churches as a pastor. And my passion has been around helping churches be who God's calling them to be and to be as healthy as possible. When the bishop asked me to be a district superintendent, by the way, the last church I was serving, we became the second largest worshiping United Methodist church here in the Wisconsin Annual Conference. I loved being there. I thought I was going to be there until I retired. And when the bishop asked me to be a district superintendent, I said, you know, I'm really not interested, bishop. Why don't you ask someone who is? Because I'm having a ball. And he said, would you pray about it? And I said, yes. And so I prayed, and in the midst of that, felt God call me to be a district superintendent. And in that process, finished 7 years of being a district superintendent, the bishop said, is there any position on the conference that you would like to do? I said, bishop, all I want to do is go back into a local church. And he said, is there any position you'd like to do? And I said, you know, I tell you, if the position of director of congregational development opened up, that's one that I could really get excited about. He said, it's open, and I want you to apply. And so I did. And what I love about what I do is I get to come be with churches. I get to invest in clergy. And as much as I love being a local church pastor myself, the gift of what I get to do now is I get to spread that with a lot of other people. And then I get to watch those pastors and those churches make a difference for the most important thing in the world. And that is the kingdom of God right here. And so it's out of that, just by way of a little introduction about who I am. I get that we sometimes have issues with the conference. I get that. I've served a church long enough to know that. But I want you to know a little bit about the face of this person who represents the annual conference before you today. I want you to know how excited our team has been to be walking with Pastor Cheryl and with your church through this MCCI process, and what a gift it was for us to be here this last week to meet with you and with your leaders. What an honor and a privilege it is for us to do that. And so my hope, my prayer is that as you begin to hear the report, and I'm not going to read through word for word. I'll read a lot of the words, but you can take it home and read it. But I want you to know how excited I am, because we see this as a beginning opportunity for what's next in your church. And so with that, I would invite you to open and turn to the first page where you get a chance to take a look at what we as a team heard were the strengths of this church. And we got to hear over and over from your leaders and congregational members the joy that you have had in music, the music ministry here at the church. It has been a strength in the church. It continues to be something that enhances worship and community life, and you have a deep appreciation for your music, and we see that as a strength. We had a chance to hear about your love and your commitment to missions, and we heard over and over about how you really like serving the needs of others. We heard about your community garden. We heard about the community meal that you do, the clothes closet, and a lot of mission efforts that have made a difference in the life of this church. Also, the strength and tradition of your church going on mission trips in the past. And so we want to just celebrate that commitment that you have to make a difference for other people. We heard over and over around your hospitality and welcome and how that leads to friendships. And I want you to know, I get an opportunity to visit an awful lot of churches. And I wish that more churches that I walked into would offer the kind of welcome that you have offered to people over and over. It was such a gift for our team to witness not only how that has made a difference for people as recently as your mystery worshipers, but for people who were members in the church and had become members of the church, in part because of the warmth and the welcome that you felt in the life of this church. It was fun to hear how some people would often say to us during this last week how coming to church feels like coming and being a part of your family. And so we want to celebrate that as a strength. We got to hear over and over again how this church has a really good, committed core of leaders. And I want you to know that that is not only recognized by your members, but we got to hear about that and we got to appreciate that as a part of the MCCI team. The other thing that the MCCI team heard as a strength is just all around your staff and your facility. We got to hear a number of times how much people appreciated Pastor Cheryl and her sermons and the creativity with worship was able to take place. We got to hear of appreciation for the commitment of people like Emily and Brittany for what they're doing with our children's ministries and our youth ministries. And we got to hear from you what a beautiful facility you have and a good strategic location that you have. And you come into this space and it is beautiful. And one of the gifts of this beauty is it helps us to begin to see and be reminded of God and God's call in our life. So those are some of the strengths that we heard. We heard a number of concerns, but the three that really rose to the top over and over again in a lot of different ways was the first is a yearning for spiritual growth and depth, and particularly to have that also be led by your pastor. We heard that that as a concern, and we heard that that really reflects a yearning on the part of leadership and part of the membership to really grow and deepen our own depth of faith. We heard about not only do you have this beautiful building, but you have too many empty spaces in this beautiful building. And we heard you give voice to not only do we have these empty spaces, but we've got people all around us and we're not quite sure how to reach them to help fill those spaces. We've heard about your yearning and desire for outreach to youth and families with children. And so we not only heard about that, as we heard about an appreciation for the work that Emily and Brittany are doing, but also then a yearning of how do we do a better job of reaching people that aren't here. So those were the three main concerns that we heard. So if you can turn the page, I can start going through then what our prescriptions are. So the first prescription that we want to offer you is we're titling Bible Study and Discipleship for Adults, Youth, and Children. And this comes in response to the yearning that Pastor Cheryl can help lead that direction for spiritual depth and growth, that we're asking Pastor Cheryl to designate during the fall of 2023 and again in the spring of 2024, and if you guys want to do it again then in the fall of 2024, etc., you can be doing that, but to develop a sermon series based on one of the Gospels, one of the Gospel books of the New Testament, designing not only her weekly worship service messages with that intentional scripture teaching and practicality for faith development as she can do, but then we're asking the Accountable Leadership Board to partner with her to organize and schedule during the fall and spring sermon series multiple sermon discussion and life application discussion group opportunities for adults. These can take place, one can take place right after worship and at other times throughout the week, and hopefully at least one with Zoom. And so what we're hoping for is that not only is Pastor Cheryl giving leadership and direction around some of these, one of these gospel passages, but then as a whole congregation, you will be able to gather together in small groups to pray for direction for your church, but pray for and respond to what are the things that are being taught in worship. And how then does that make a difference for you in your own life? And our goal is that we can have every adult who's a part of the church be a part of one of those groups. And so Cheryl and the ALB can organize a variety of different small groups. But then, in addition to doing that for adults, that Cheryl could work with both Emily and Brittany to create age-appropriate learning and discussion guides for the children and youth of the church as well. And the hope is that the whole church can be focusing around common scriptural themes and questions to help focus you and direct you towards the future. So that's the first prescription. The second prescription is around repurposing. And this is in response to the concern about the buildings being underutilized. And I'm really excited about this, but to work with the ALB and to identify a new short-term facility vision team. This team can assume the responsibility of researching and exploring exciting new options for leveraging available rooms and spaces for the church for missional community purposes and creating a purpose to bring to the ALB on or before January of 2024. So what are we really talking about here? Well, let me say, we will assign a prescription coach who can help inform and guide this team. And we're going to invite you as a team to look at the following things, to carefully consider the demographic information, the Mission Insight reports around your surrounding community, so that you as a congregation can gain clarity around who is it that lives right around you as a part of your mission field. We heard numerous times when we were here this last week, we're not quite sure who's all around us and what their needs are. And so what we want to do is we want to help bring a coach in who can help you understand. One of those pieces is to look at that demographic information. A second piece is to make appointments for strategic conversations with people like school principals, local civic leaders, nonprofit, local service organizations, business connections that you have, possibly through the Chamber of Commerce and others, for the purpose of learning what unmet needs exist in Hartford that could be addressed by or hosted at First United Methodist Church. As an aside, one of my hopes every time I went to a church was to try to get to know the community so well that I could understand what are the needs that nobody else is meeting, and how can our church begin to fill that gap? Because when we begin to fill that gap, what we do is we let people understand we love them so much that we want to help introduce them to a God that loves them and wants to help them be whole. The third potential is possibly a creation of a cooperative shared space partnerships with nonprofits that provide services of support, resourcing, and care that could utilize available rooms right here at the church. The goal of all of this is to help provide your church with a dynamic, relevant, new go-to presence in your community for missional impact and community good. And we would ask, as a part of all of this, that you have another emphasis around prayer walking for the entire church. Prayer walk in this space and start asking God to help bring the people here that God needs to help make a difference in their life. And we're asking that you organize teams to prayer walk around your community so that God can help you see what are the needs that are there and the people that are there so that your church can begin to reach them. One of our MCCI churches that has done this prayer walking in their community, it's a very different community, so I'm just lifting this up as an example of what a difference prayer walking can make. What they realized in that community, it's a suburb of a really large city, but they're not in the downtown area where it's so obvious that there's a food desert. But as they walked around and did that prayer, one of the things that they discovered is they started coming back and they started hearing reports of, well, we're not the food desert of the downtown area, but here's where our pockets of need are. And as they started to identify that through prayer walking, they started asking God, how do we meet that need? And to this day, what they have done is they've started a new ministry. They actually bought a food truck, and they're delivering food to those areas. But here's the deal. What I absolutely love, their mission coordinator has said, our job is not to provide food. Our job is to build relationships for Jesus, and food is just our tool. And so our invitation is for you as a team to start prayer walking different parts of your community to see what are the needs that God has provided for you. The third prescription that we're offering up is really how do we connect with the next generation? It's really around learning about that triad strategy. We heard over and over that we want to develop children and youth ministries even more than what we have, but we're not always quite sure how. So what we want to do is provide a coach who can help you develop your own triad strategy. And for those of you that are looking at me like, well, what are you talking about? This is one of the, when I was here to do the Resource Refocus event, the triad strategy is really around developing not just a one-off series, but a one-off gathering, but it's really how do we develop a series of related events that help us build relationships with people that can invite them then to be a part of who the church is and how the church is trying to make a difference. And we specifically identified Emily and Brittany and the leaders that they work with who serve in the children and youth ministries as a part of to offer this training for. But we are aware that there may be other leaders here at the church that want to learn more about that. And maybe some of you who heard from the demographic study that we had the other night that your fastest growing demographic is age 65 and older. And so you might want to have some people, and maybe even Victoria and the hospitality committee would like to be a part of this strategy to learn how do we utilize that to reach new people for Jesus Christ. And so those are the three prescriptions that we're offering up for you. And if you turn the page one more time, you'll see that we've offered an addendum here. Now this addendum, we do this on occasion. This is not a prescription. So when you vote, what you're really voting on is the rest of the report. This addendum is available if you decide to say, yes, we want to partner with the conference and have prescription coaches come. Then one of the things that if your ALB wants to say, we would like to take part of having also a systems, church systems coach who would advise the ALB to take a look at best practices around redistributing and reassigning certain pieces of responsibilities for Pastor Cheryl that she is currently doing. If we can get a group of people to say, what are you currently doing? How can we help you reassign some of this so that you can focus around spirituality, but yet we're still having some of the other systems needs that are being met for us? We will, if you so choose and ask for that, we will provide that type of a coach to come on in and work with your ALB to look at Pastor Cheryl and some of your other staffing if that needs to be as well. So this is our report that we are offering up to you. You might want, I'll be around afterwards, by the way, if you want to ask me any questions or visit with me at all, I'd be happy to do that, because I want to tell you I'm so excited about the potential and possibility to partner with you. And I want you to know Bishop Jung is really excited about that as well. In fact, Bishop Jung sent me a text this morning before I left. He knew that I was going to be here this day. And he said, would you please tell the people at First Church Hartford that they are in my prayers and they will be through this next month as you go through the process. So you might wonder, what's next? You've got the report. As you've heard from before, there will be three town hall meetings over the next little more than 30 days. Well, actually, over the next 30 days. One of those is going to be next Sunday at 10 a.m. right after church. And then on Wednesday, August 16th, and on Sunday, August 20th. And these town hall meetings, really, as a reminder, they're not meant to say, how do we do this? Because we're going to, if you choose to accept the report, we're going to come and walk with you to help you do it until you get traction. It really is to ask the question, are these the next steps for us? And it's not to say that you don't have other things that you need to work on, because you may. But as a team, we are saying that we believe that these are just some of the very next steps, which I think, frankly, helps set the groundwork for the more that I know many of you are hoping to do and desiring to do. And so the facilitators for these will be identified by Pastor Cheryl in conjunction with your MCCI team. And then you will vote on whether to embrace or not this report at an official church conference, which will be held with your district superintendent, Reverend Dr. Ebenezer Insor. He was here this last week with us, and that will be on Sunday, September 10th at 9:45 a.m. And so, my friends, I just want you to know I have been praying for you. I have been praying for you for a year now. And as I've read your report and listened to people, I just want you to know that you will continue to be in my prayers as you walk through this next month. And I bet you might be interested in knowing how Pastor Cheryl is feeling about this. And so, Cheryl, I want to invite you to come.
How am I feeling about it? It's nothing that hasn't already been said. These are not things new. I'm looking at a member of our ALB right now that her and I have talked about the prescription in number two. It was brought before the ALB, even before our meeting. None of what was said in our report is not something that we've already said. So I fielded some phone calls on Friday after our meeting on Thursday night. I didn't get to all of them. I didn't get responses back to everybody, but the ones that I did talk to, maybe you're thinking, that's all there is? It's just three things? That's it? Well, that is, because that's what it was supposed to be. MCCI process isn't, and it never was meant to be, a five-year strategy plan. It's always been about the immediate next steps. And so I thought about this last night as I was sitting there, and I thought, you know what? We're the Giants. We're a team. We need to get something going. And I'm excited about it because we have a playlist for the first set of downs. But after that 10 yards, we still have the ball. And it's ours. Because once you get the ball moving, the momentum picks up, okay? And I think we can figure it out from here. But the question is, are we gonna do it as a team? And I can't answer that, only you can. But I do know that it's getting late in the game. Because what we looked at on Thursday night, and we looked at the life cycle of our church, we're not over here. We're not young, okay? It's getting a little late in the game, and we need to do something. And these are not complicated plays. It's not like, you know, that helter-skelter play where everybody's running every different direction. This isn't it. This is very much what we know in our hearts needs to be done. And we have a treasure in this church, and sometimes I think we hide it. We bury it. And we can leave it there, or we can bring it out and use every single member of this church to do these things, and then do some more strategic visioning and some more strategic planning. Because I think what we said in the beginning was, we have a lot of ideas, but we have a hard time implementing them. So once we get some confidence around implementation and we know what we can do, I don't think the Super Bowl is that big of a goal anymore. I think we can do this because this is a Jesus-led movement that we're in. And the movement and the kingdom was never supposed to stay in one place. So I say we suit up and go for it. Let's pray our 7:38 prayer together. Because this is what we need. God, we lift this up to you in prayer. Please do what we cannot do ourselves. We need you to break through into our lives, our congregation, and our community. Use us together for unimagined new purposes on behalf of Christ. Break through any barriers that stand in your way and hold us back. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Please stand if you are able and let's sing about Jesus. Number 189, Fairest Lord Jesus. For our prayers today, we always list prayers in our bulletin for us to keep in our hearts and in our prayers during the week. And we continue to pray for Rosie and for Joan and for Kevin, baby Diana, Camille, the family of Evie Antonopoulos. Her funeral will be next Saturday, August 5th at 1 p.m. at Shimon's Funeral Home. We also continue to pray for Elizabeth. Sharon Cowan is watching today, and she is asking prayers because she's moving, I believe, this next week to a new permanent home in Brookfield. So prayers for Sharon, and also prayers for Jill and her family as they will have a celebration of life for her daughter Marissa tomorrow. So please be praying for the family of Marissa. Also prayers for Ann Conroy and her dad Almer on the death of Ann's brother David in Alabama. So this is difficult, so please pray for them. I'm just double checking. Are there also, Mark Martin had some heart surgery this last week, so we continue to pray for him. Are there any other prayers that we need to add? Nedra? Yes. I've got her on another, and I forgot to flip my screen. Carla Kermoris' dad, David, has entered hospice, so please be in prayers for Carla and her family. Thank you for that reminder, Nedra.
Can you praise baby Diana got to go home after 6.5 months in the NHS? And her mom said that she would hear over the balcony for baby so-and-so is going home. They announced it when they go home. And she said, I just wondered if I would ever get to hear that.
Baby Diana got to go home. Yay, we've been praying for her for six. We'll keep her in our prayers, but for months and months.
Yes, great. Just thank you for prayers for my mom. She did get through rehab. She managed to stay the whole week. And she's home and even contemplating getting
some treatment on the bathroom. Okay, continue prayers for Pat, who made it through rehab. Awesome. Anything else? Tony.
Susan's at home. She's suffering with a sinus headache, but we are still going to quietly celebrate our 40th wedding anniversary today.
Congratulations! Happy anniversary! Also, do we know how many we served at the community lunch yesterday, Larry?
Yeah, we had 80 guests served 150 meals yesterday.
Thank you. All right, let's be in prayer. God of all wisdom and profound mystery, we are grateful for all the signs and the wonders that you scatter in our world like seeds. We ask that you be with those in our congregation, our community, and our world in need of a relationship with you. We pray for those that we have lifted up, those who are sick, those who are grieving. And there are so many things going on in our lives and in our world. Sometimes we feel helpless and that our faith isn't big enough to matter, but help us to know that we are enough and that the smallest of acts of faith can, by your grace, take root in our hearts and grow. And that one day, in the fullness of time, we may not only be welcomed into your eternal realm, but may recognize it as home. God, we ask that you be with us. We gather all of our prayers together, those we have spoken out loud and those on our hearts. We bring them before you, praying the prayer that Jesus taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now we come to a time, there's not a video today, is there? Okay, all right. Sometimes I couldn't remember where we were at today, but we do come to a time when we offer back to God a portion of all that we are given, that we have been given. And all of that is gathered together and planted together to grow a crop of the kingdom of heaven right here in Hartford. So I ask our ushers to come forward and take our morning offering. pray with me. God of power and glory, as we bring our tithes and offerings to be dedicated to the building of your kingdom here on earth, we are reminded of all the blessings we have received. With it, we worship you and give our whole selves to you. Take it now and use it for your kingdom and your glory. Extend and multiply its reach and influence, we pray. May it be a great blessing to many. We ask all this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Closing song this morning is found in the Worship and Song book, Just a Little Talk with Jesus, number 3107. Let's sing. Thank you for all that you have done for this church. I am grateful to be standing here in front of you, and I want you to know that MCCI doesn't stop now. It keeps going. We have a lot more work to do, but in the end, it's all about sharing the kingdom of God right here in Hartford. So go with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said.
Amen.